Let me start by saying one word, an acronym actually, three letters, CSI. You make my point already. Had I made that statement to an audience like you 7 years ago, I'm certain all of you, at least most, would have looked at each other and said, what is he saying? Just as I now realize that you all are perfectly well aware of what I'm saying, at least to a point. Because what I'm going to talk about this morning is something a little bit different. It's about the illegal use of wildlife and the illegal use of plants and oil spills and hazardous waste dumps and damaged coral reefs and the application of CSI to those problems of sustainability on our planet. And you're bound to ask me, what about climate change? That's an awfully large crime scene. Let us step back a little bit and do the easier ones first. You probably have a sense of what CSI is, at least in the police element, but then you may be asking yourself, well, wait a minute. There's no CSI wildlife on TV, no CSI waste dumps, no CSI oil spills. Well, there's going to be. I have no doubt. I would just like real life to be a little bit ahead of television, if you don't mind. Besides, I'm going to give away a secret, not a real unknown secret. Real CSIs are not detectives. Real CSIs are not forensic scientists. It's not a glamorous job. It's a dirty job. It's a tiring job. And beyond anything else, my former partner, a large hairy man with a love for Italian food and wine, would have looked lousy in a bustier in high heels. So before we go any further, I want to make sure that we all understand the reality of what CSI is all about. Some basics, a science, if you don't mind, it will be painless. CSI, forensics, is using science to answer legal questions. They're really simple questions. Who, what, when, where, how, and why. That's the basics of CSI. And by the way, we also use bright lights in our laboratory. It's very hard to see when the lights are purple. The purpose of CSI, what are we doing? We're determining if a crime has been committed. That's crucial element number one. We're trying to identify the victims and the suspects. We're collecting evidence related to the scenes. We're trying to reenact the crime events if we can. And lastly, most importantly, and the thing that is always shown on the TV shows, we're trying to link suspect, victim, and crime scene together in a triangular manner. That is CSI reality. But there's some premises, some elements. This is simple stuff. This is not brain surgery. This is getting dirty on your hands and knees. It's impossible, absolutely impossible, for suspect, victim, and crime scene to come together, especially if it's in a violent manner, without the exchange of evidence, without the creation of evidence. And that applies to trace evidence mostly. That transfer could be a single hair or fiber, not easy to find. A latent fingerprint, latent being invisible, those are much easier to find. A footprint or a tire track. Or, in the case of the coral reefs, the big chunk off the end of a 100,000-pound anchor. Trace evidence may vary. There's a problem. Anybody who enters a crime scene is either going to create evidence, damage evidence, or leave or pick up evidence. Now, specifically, we're talking about the suspect and victim, of course. We're talking about the neighbors. We're also talking about every officer, including the crime scene investigators who enter that crime scene. Primary CSI tasks, what are we supposed to be doing? There's three things. We're supposed to evaluate the scene and the evidence. We're supposed to document that scene and evidence. And we're supposed to preserve and we're supposed to collect that evidence. Now, of those three, two of them are mechanical. Two of them you can do without thinking, which is very handy at 2 o'clock in the morning. And you're on your hands and knees, and what your sustenance is going to be a cold cup of coffee in another hour. You don't want to be thinking a whole lot. You want to collect, you want to preserve the evidence and document it as you're doing it. The thinking part of CSI is nice. You want to be able to do that when you can. The TV shows show that, of course. Example of a mechanical wildlife crime scene. We raided in Alaska the home, the trailer, of the head of an outlaw biker gang who was arranging with native Eskimos to kill walruses on the ice floes, chop their heads off, take their tusks and other parts of the bodies, and send it to him so he could sell these materials to wildlife carvers down in the United States who could collect genuine Eskimo scrimshaw that is created and put it back up into Alaska. I was there for 13 hours. I filled out 324 evidence tags. There was little thinking, mostly doing. The thinking part came later when those headless walruses washed ashore 30 days later. We responded to the scene. We waited around in decomposed walrus guts trying to figure out what happened. We weren't trying to link anybody to anything. We were just trying to see if a crime had really occurred. Then we get to class versus individual. This is a crucial part of forensic science. Class characteristics. You all heard yesterday that us humans are pretty much alike, 99% of our DNA. Well, we've got a bunch of class characteristics. We've got hands, we've got feet, we've got a head, nose, ears. Generally, we're all alike in that manner. Wonderful variations. Eventually, we get down to individual characteristics, our blood type, our fingerprints, and all that. But mostly, we're class characteristics. Like a hammer, you have a handle and something big on the end. There's many variations on that theme. Another way of looking at it, class characteristics, a vehicle, the make, model, the year it was made, those are class characteristics. You can individualize that vehicle by adding a license plate, ideally a unique one, and damaging it at random. And that's, random is really an interesting part of forensic science. I'm going to demonstrate randomness and uniqueness. I just did it. I've created a unique jigsaw puzzle match. These two pieces of paper match each other exactly. I could, if I wanted to waste a really good tree, hand out 1,000 of these to each of you. You could spend the entire day tearing them just like I did. Not one of you would be able to match either of these two pieces. It will never happen. That is uniqueness. Class characteristics. What are we talking about? Well, the chemical structure of heroin is a classic example. Any structure, every heroin molecule is exactly alike all over the world. No language problems. Tread patterns on a brand new pair of shoes, ABO typing, weight, size of a cartridge, a bullet, the make and model of a firearm, all class characteristics. Individual, that old good old fingerprint. For those of you wearing Havaianas today, unless you bought them 10 minutes ago, they are now individualistic, because if you take them off and look at them in the bottoms, they're torn up. Randomly, uniquely. If I were to take the time, I could show where each of you have been sitting based on your footprint in front of your chairs. It's an awful lot of work. I don't think I'm going to. The most important thing to remember, you can never positively link suspect and victim to a crime scene with class characteristics. You cannot say, as an eyewitness, the suspect was about this height, dark tanned skin, dark eyes, dark hair. That's him, I'm sure, that's him. No. That might be useful class characteristics if that person was in Sweden. It's not useful here in Amazonia. And it doesn't matter where it's useful or not, because you should never try to prove that person was there based on those characteristics. You must use individual characteristics. Another simple thing, the wildlife environmental crime scenes are exactly the same as human scenes, except for a couple things. And I'm sorry about this one. Your victim is a non-human animal. Number two, it may be legal or illegal to kill that animal based on a number of things. What is it? Is it something that can be killed? Two, when did you kill it? Is there a hunting season involved? And did you kill it at 5 o'clock in the morning or 7 o'clock in the morning when hunting season started at six? Location, were you in the right spot? Were you standing on the right side of a county or city or state line? What type of weapon did you use? Knife, gun, bow, golf club? It varies as to what is legal. Do you have a hunting license? And interestingly enough, was it self-defense? In almost every country, it is perfectly legal for you to kill an endangered species if you're defending your own life. Hazardous waste dumping. The questions to be answered: who, what, when, where, why, how. I don't have to go further than that. You all have a sense. You have a sense of what those dumps are. You have a sense they're hazardous, not just to the public, the population, the planet, but to you as an investigator. You have to be careful. Simpler questions are to be answered for coral reefs. What caused the damage? Who caused it? Those same who, what, when, where. But with a coral reef, this is a little more complicated. This is a little more tricky, because in its natural state, coral reef does not have the damage coming at it. There's undeveloped land, a beach, a current, things are well. Typical damaged coral reef today, perhaps 50% of our coral reefs are damaged beyond saving. And there's all kinds of things that could be impacting them, and if you look around and you start assessing the scene, what could have caused that damage? Nearby military base, runoffs, same kinds of things from an industrial site, oils. If there's a river nearby, you have a sense of what could be in the Amazon and what could go out into the ocean. Runoffs from parking lots, from docks. A ship runs aground, intentionally or not. A ship's captain just dumps because he's in the mood or it's handy or it costs less. And then you have this mass of something that started out hundreds or thousands of kilometers away and just happens to go through that reef. And you have the poachers who are trying to steal tropical fish, who put bleach and cyanide into the water to stun these fish, and that bleach goes down to the coral reefs. And you end up with that. You end up with a mess that CSI has to separate apart. So in 2006, ICRI decided to ID these things. They said, we need to ID the source of damage, we need to accurately assess what's going on, we need to be prepared to go to court. CSI ought to do the job. They watch TV too. Now, ideally, coral reef would be a thinking process, but there's a problem here, time. Time in the water is an issue, and there may not be time to do much more than simply collect. Mostly, sadly, CSI is going to have to be a mechanical process. Unavoidable land problems, you don't know what the scene was like before suspect and victim interacted. So when you enter that scene, you're going to make mistakes, you're going to step on things, you're going to drive over the tracks of a suspect. You can't help it. It's an act of faith when you enter a crime scene. Unavoidable coral reef problem, you don't know what that reef was like before the impact occurred, and you don't have it documented. So, the ICRI Coral Reef team, six international marine biologists who knew nothing about CSI or forensics or evidence, one CSI forensic scientist who had to quickly learn to scuba dive, me, in 6 degrees centigrade Oregon water. Yeah, lovely. I had to qualify as a U.S. diver. This would not have been a problem had I been 20 to 30 years old. That wasn't the case. I was 60 at the time, and I was afraid of sharks, and I'm in open water. We met in Cozumel to check out the reefs, to see the local residents, and to start learning from each other. I'm learning too. I've got a lot of things to learn. I've got to learn that everything I know how to do on land doesn't work in the water, starting with taking a picture. The currents are dragging me away. And I'm very much aware that I really shouldn't look like a slow, dumb seal. My other problems in life, limited time in the scene. I've only got 3 dives, possibly 4 at the most, depending on depth. I can't set a scene perimeter. It's too long. I'll use up all my air. The body doesn't go to a morgue, to an autopsy. It stays right where it is. Can't make notes in ink. I have to keep track of the evidence. Currents are a pain. Things that bite show up at crime scenes. I'm not used to that. These first 20 biologist students helping with advice. I've still got a problem. This picture is evidence. I wandered away from my dive partner. Dumb, lost, not very smart. Most important thing we learned, teamwork. So here's the first graduating class. There's one special, Juliana, a TED senior fellow who's here today. Now I have to tell you something. We all know in law enforcement that we can't solve problems. Law enforcement never does. The best we can do is hold things at bay till smarter, more thoughtful, more visionary people come along. I'm looking out at this audience with great pride and joyfulness because my sense is those smarter, thoughtful people have finally started to arrive. So with all my heart, I thank you for being here, and I thank you for being who you are. Obrigado.